As the demand for vinyl continues to grow, the industry has had to up its game. High-quality pressings, once the preserve of audio files with expensive equipment, are now becoming the norm, as today's vinyl buyers demand that the quality of the product matches the price. Vinyl reached its peak commercially and technically in the early 1980s, before being cut down in its prime by the CD. But now, 40 years later, there exists a small, highly skilled group of mastering engineers who are dedicated to carrying on where that technology left off, and are not only committed to continuing vinyl's legacy, but improving it. And one of its finest is Miles Showell. Since coming to Abbey Road in 2013, Miles has almost single-handedly revived the art of half-speed mastering and has produced some of the finest-sounding vinyl of the modern era. A few weeks ago, Miles kindly agreed to meet me at Abbey Road for this channel's first one-to-one interview, which was an offer I couldn't refuse. So here we are at Abbey Road. It's 8 o'clock in the morning, and things are already moving quite fast. I've already been in a taxi where a driver recognised me, the first person I met in London. Anyway, so we're going into Abbey Road today. Let's see how we get on. Look who we find walking down the street. It's Mr. Miles Showell. Good morning, sir.
Hello.
How are you? Okay, this is going to be an interesting day. And after taking the obligatory shots on the front steps, went inside for what was to be an unforgettable day. We began with an incredible whistle-stop tour. Studio 1, the magical Studio 2, the Echo Chamber, and Studio 3. It was then onto the Abbey Road canteen, where I was treated to a proper English breakfast. We sat down in Miles's mastering room, or the listening room of your dreams, for what was to be a wide-ranging interview covering many fascinating topics, including the challenges and rewards of cutting at half speed, how he feels about analogue versus digital, the equipment he uses both at work and at home, about working with Glyn Johns on Get Back, and why he thinks vinyl will continue to get better and better. We began our conversation by talking about the early days of his career and about his memorable first cut.
When did I cut my first record? Well, that goes back quite a long way. I got my very first job after I left school. I started in September 1984, and they wouldn't let me anywhere near the lathe at the beginning because they're quite fragile, quite easily broken, and if you damage some stuff, it's very expensive to fix. But about 3 months into the job, they were commissioned to cut the masters for the Band-Aid single, Do They Know It's Christmas? And at that time, there were no satellite delivery. You couldn't send the file online to people for radio stations. And the record label was so generous with the Band-Aid Trust that what they actually did was they cut acetates, one acetate for all of the DJs on BBC Radio 1 and one acetate for every commercial radio station in the country. And they biked the acetates, even up to, there's a radio station in Inverness, they sent the acetates on a bike. So we had to do 45 acetates of Do They Know It's Christmas. I cut 40 of those because the engineer who cut it, he had already cut 10 sets of lacquers and he was getting a bit sick of hearing it really. So, okay, Miles, this is the order of sequence. You push the buttons and this is what you do. Next disc on. So yeah, I did 45 acetates or thereabouts of Do They Know It's Christmas. That's the first thing I cut. Not actual master for a pressing, but the radio station copies that were broadcast before they came out. And a long time ago, I was in the Hard Rock Cafe near Piccadilly Circus and looked up on the wall, thought, oh, there's a Utopia acetate stuck on the wall. I wonder what that is. I got up my chair, looked at it, and It was one of my acetates for Do They Know It's Christmas with Band-Aid. So there you go, stuck on the wall. Probably long gone now, but it was there. The first thing I cut that was actually released was... good question. I think it was an independent record label who would put out some obscure dance music, and they were called Greyhound Records. They used to import records, and they also put out a few things they'd license. They'd license all sorts of stuff. It wasn't just dance music. They did rock music as well, some kind of pretty heavy, like American death metal stuff. And there was a track, it was actually quite racist. It was called Swiss Boy, and it was by an Italian artist called Lou Cern, would you believe? And it was basically just slagging off this guy from Switzerland who'd run off with his girlfriend. So no one's ever heard it since, but I'm sure if you can look around, there'll be a YouTube video somewhere of that. I first came across half-speed mastering when I was a schoolboy and I was into my hi-fi. My dad used to have a record shop and he got some promotional stuff came through. Included in that were some of the early Mobile Fidelity Sound Labs cuts. So there was The Dark Side of the Moon was in there, and Magical Mystery Tour, and Abbey Road, which they all released as independent standalone releases, as well as the box set. And I bought these and I just thought, God, these, especially Dark Side of the Moon, these records sound incredible. You know, never heard records sound that good. And when I got to working, I would always say to my bosses, I really want to get into half speed because I've got these albums and they're amazing. And they said, no, it's too complicated. You've got to change lots of things. It's not just a case of slowing down the lathe. Lots of other stuff has to happen underneath the, you know, in the control panels and stuff. You can't just flick a switch and it happens. So, no, it's too difficult. And then around about 20 years ago, I mentioned it to a maverick technical person who I still work very closely with. And he said, do you know what? It might be the right time to give this a go. So we did a very crude lash up to kind of just to test the principle. And the tests were good enough for us to actually build the custom filters that you need. Yeah, I got into it just purely by being a fan of good sounding records. And it's really grim to work on half speed, you know, and I'm sitting here hour after hour cutting music at the wrong speed. It's very tough. And I never leave the room while I'm cutting a master, because you just know that the 1 minute I'm run off to the toilet or something, that's when something's going to go wrong and I'm not going to hear it. So, you know, I'm sat here and I've had 14, 15 hour non-stop days of half speed audio. It's dreadful, you know, it really does sound bad. But when you get the records back and you put them on, and there's just this extra bit of sazz, you know, you just don't get normally. It just makes it worthwhile. You think, yeah, that's why I sat there for that long day, because this just sounds otherworldly. The percentage of my work that's half speed is probably 60%. So I'll do 40% real time, cutting times one, normal speed. And the other 60% is half speed. Not everything I do is half speed. It costs quite a lot more. It takes a lot longer to do. It's not just twice as long, because we insist that everybody has an acetate of everything that's done as a half-speed cut, which I'll play. I've got a domestic turntable just in the corner over there, which is not esoteric. It's good hi-fi, but not ridiculously good hi-fi. So my logic is, if that can play it, then we're good. There's no point in trying to make a record sound good on a little briefcase type cheap turntable, because everything sounds bad on those. If I was to compromise it to make it sound okay on that, it would sound boring on everybody else's record player. So as long as you've got something that's even reasonably good, you can hear a difference between real time and half speed. So we play the acetate, I check it's good. Very often the client will also have it after I've played it and they'll check it too. Then I cut it. So it's kind of four times as long across two sessions, because I'm doing it twice. So it takes a lot longer and obviously costs more. I don't do it all the time, but if people really want it, we're here for it. What qualities do you need to be a mastering engineer? It's quite a curious mix of mechanical engineering, if you're going to do disc cutting, because that's purely mechanical, that machine there. Obviously, audio engineering, and a little bit of, I don't know, how do you put it, stubborn old woman, really. You just need to be really particular about certain things and, you know, just go to the nth degree. You know, you can't just go, oh, yeah, that'll do, because that doesn't work, because inevitably little things go wrong. And if little things go wrong, they turn into very big problems once you get into production. So you have to have ridiculous OCD levels of attention to detail. So yeah, probably a fairly curious mix. There's not that many of us who do it who have all those qualities. And I like to think I've got a few of them, you know, some of the OCD, definitely, that's for sure. What percentage of my work is from digital sources and what is from analog? Probably the vast majority these days is digital. Anything new is digital. Very, very, very rare to get a new album on tape. I think the last new album I got on tape was maybe 10 years ago. So it just doesn't really happen anymore. Tape's not as good as it was. There are a couple of companies making tape. It's not like it was, you know, in the 60s, 70s and 80s when we were at the peak of tape, you know. So a lot of digital stuff. If I'm doing a remaster of an old album, if I possibly can, I like to get hold of the original tape if it's available. Certain companies will supply tape. Lots of them don't. We're lucky that it's Abbey Road and it has a reputation of being very careful with your masters. So where other studios may struggle to get a tape, I can sometimes get one, because I have a wonderful machine for which I have my own custom heads, which sound amazing. And I can normally get a better transfer from the tape than if it's just from the archive copy. But certain labels just won't send me stuff. But it can be a problem. And even vintage digital can be a problem. I've had digital tapes from the 80s, masters, that don't play anymore. You know, one famous session I did for an artist, and the tape was in an archive in Los Angeles. And this is a company that famously do not send their tapes to anybody. And so the only thing we can send you is a copy of the production master made in 1985. We can't get the master to play, so you can't have it. And I said, well, I've worked with this format since it was new. I know, you know, all the tricks you can bring in to cajole it to work. Why don't you send it? Oh, no, we can't send it because it might get lost in transit. And I said, but you can't play it. It's useless to you. Why don't you send it and maybe I can get something out of it? And they refused. And then I spoke to the artist who screamed at them and they relented and they sent the tape. And it took three of us working, you know, fighting the machine, but we got it to play. So there is now an archive transfer of the master of that tape. A lot of people like to think, oh, you can just play the tape. And you can't just keep playing tape. Every time you run it, something falls off, something moves. You're bringing the tape across the head. So it causes wear. And it's not good to keep passing these tapes over and over and over again. I know this is a famous Beatles channel. So the Beatles tapes are all archived. They come out from the archive as infrequently as possible, the tapes, because we're trying to preserve them. We don't want them worn out. There's no point in running them, you know. We could probably run them all 20 times a year, but in 5 years they'd fall to pieces, and we don't want to do that. You know, we're custodians of this stuff. We want to look after it for the next generations. And you know, it might be that people can recover stuff that we can't recover now because the tape's damaged, and they can find a way to fix it. But if we played it 25 35 45 times and worn it out, it's gone. It's beholden upon us really to look after this stuff, to make it as preserved as well as it can be. Yeah, knowing when to stop making adjustments is one of the hardest things, and you have to just not spend too long, basically. If you start EQing your EQ, and then you just add more and more, and you lose sight of where you were. So the trick is really to do as little as possible. I'm fairly hands-off if I can be. Sometimes you'll get a recording that's a real mess that just needs every toy you've got to throw at it just to try and lift something out and make it sound okay. But if it comes in sounding good, I'm not going to stamp loads of EQ and compression all over something just because I can, because it's not for me to do that, really. It's unless I'm being asked, can you do that? I won't do that, because the engineers and the producers at the time, if they generally knew what they were doing, so let's not stamp all over their work. Now and again, you might get a track where one album was done by a different producer or a different engineer, sounds completely different. And you've got to try and, you know, reach an equilibrium point so that everything works together as an album, but without changing the sound too much, because I don't want to upset the engineer from whichever session it was that you know, that I've had to EQ. But yeah, in an ideal world, I'll be as hands-off as possible. Which is the easiest media to work on? Well, the easiest media to work on is digital, because you load the file into the workstation, you press the space bar and it's playing. You know, it's easy. But I like working with tape. Tape's just something about it, just the fact you've got to, you know, cajole the machine. And also you get a rest. If you're working on a track and it's a digital file, I can just press stop, control, home, play. And the music never stops. With tape, you have to stop the machine, rewind it. It takes a while to wind back to the zero point and then you play it again. And that actually just gives you a rest and it's less tiring. And because it's far more hands-on, I prefer working with analog sources, but you don't get them too often, you know. And for the same reasons, I prefer cutting records than making digital masters. So you may be able to see behind me, there's this cutting lathe. I love cutting records because you've got any one of 15 things that could go wrong at any point that ruin it. So, you know, you've got to keep watching this and watching that. Is it getting too hot? Is the current high? You know, and I'm trying to, you know, play with it. And you're riding, you know, on a tightrope all the time. And if you get everything right, it can sound incredible, as we all know. So that's the challenge, is to kind of get it just on the verge of collapsing, but still good. And then you know you've got a good cut. And that's the fun of it. Whereas with the digital release, it's kind of, well, is it loud enough? Is it bright enough? Okay, then. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's fine. And we do that. I do that too. A lot of the time, I'm just doing stuff that's not coming out on records. And I'm happy to do anything. But the most fun I have in my job is to cut vinyl. My main go-to equipment here, I've got several equalizers that I like to use. I've got a hand-built equalizer built by a company called Sontech. Very small company based in Gold Barn, Virginia. And it's a guy there who basically builds these equalizers on his kitchen table. He gets all the components, hand-matches them all, doesn't have an email address, rarely answers the phone. Real quirky guy, but very clever. Makes very nice equalizers. I've got another equalizer from a company called Masalec, which is really nice. Try not to use too many things. There are some other toys in the desk, but they're not all mine. They're not all Abbey Road's. I share this room with a different engineer, so some of the tools in the desk are his. But my absolute favorite tool to use is I've got a valve compressor tube for your American viewers. This is a very authentic recreation of the legendary Fairchild 670 compressor, built by a friend of mine. It takes him 80 man hours to build it. Uses the same transformers, the same tubes, the same capacitors, the same switches as the original Fairchild compressor. And it's just gorgeous. I have one massive problem with it, and that's stopping myself putting it on everything, because it just, even regularly I'll run it with all thresholds set to zero, so it's not doing any compression or any limiting or anything. It's just going through that tube circuitry, it's adding its goodness, and it just somehow makes things sound more open, more 3D, and just more lively. It's just a really, really great unit. It was ferociously expensive, and I don't let anybody else touch it, but it's incredible. That's really, I wouldn't like to say a secret weapon, but it's certainly one of my favorite things I love to use. Behind me here, there's a Neumann VMS-80 lathe, which originally was a VMS-82, which was the DMM version, because DMM's kind of fallen out of favor now, largely, certainly in this world. I had it converted to lacquer cutting. My engineers who worked on it with me, they said, oh yeah, it'll take about 9 months. And that was very wishful thinking. It took them 18 months. To be fair to them though, it could have been quicker, but I had them do lots of modifications. It's tweaked to my spec because that's my lathe, that one. So I've got custom power supply in it, lots of custom boards put in there, better sounding capacitors in the signal path, better transistors in the amplifiers. Anything we could improve, we've improved. And they said, well, we can just get it working and then come back after 6 months and then change it. Well, I said, no, you've got a jigsaw puzzle, because it was in bits. It was literally in 100 bits. And I said, seeing as you've got to piece it all together anyway and work out how it goes back together, why don't we just, as we go, we just change all the parts we want to change. So, and that's an ongoing process. I haven't just stopped since it got installed. You know, I've imported and installed more custom parts for it, and there are more to come. So the latest thing I've got in there, I've got a prototype nut. There's a nut which attaches to a big screw in there, which drives a cutter head across the disc. And I've got a new plastic, very, very slippy plastic nut, which is really, really silent, because Neumann, when they built those lathes, they had a sintered bronze nut, which was great, really, really, absolute marvel of engineering for 1982. But things can be done better now. So I've got this very hard, very slippy plastic nut, and it's absolutely silent. And I've even had people notice that the records that I've cut, there's nothing between the tracks. It's like really quiet. I said, well, that's my new toy. So yeah, it's an ongoing process of continual improvement, gradually trying to improve it. So, you know, better wire between the amplifiers and the head, everything. Anything we can do to just keep pushing it to bring 35, 40 years of development to the process, because Neumann don't make lathes anymore. They haven't made them since the 1980s. There's nothing new coming out of there. So it's up to us to try to keep the whole thing going, keep them working, and make them sound as good as they can. How different was it cutting records in the 60s? That's a really good question, and I can't give you a very qualified answer, because I wasn't really around in the 60s. Only just, I was a very, very small person in the 60s. However, I've looked back at what was available to people, and it was pretty crude by today's standard. I mean, cutting half-speed records was not a new thing. We had Mobile Fidelity and Stan Ricker doing it in the late 70s, early 80s. But prior to that, in the 1960s, Decca would do half-speed for their classical albums. They had a very, very high-quality mono-only cutting system, the FFRR system, and that would cut beautiful sounding records, but it wouldn't work in stereo. And those were the days when you'd have parallel releases. You have a mono LP and a stereo LP, and they didn't want to put out fabulous sounding mono and not very good stereo, because the early cutting systems weren't great for stereo. So they elected to cut at half speed with some modifications that they'd made so that they could get the high frequency content as clean as possible in stereo. So yeah, it was definitely crude. You have to take your hat off to the people that came before, because the whole problems of disc spacing and working out the grooves, you know, I have a computer in that lathe there behind me, which is very good at packing the grooves in, especially at half speed, because it's got twice as long to think about it. And it really does, when you've got a long side that you want to try and cut loud, it's really fighting to try and mushroom all the grooves together and get it all nicely packed to be as efficient with the space as possible. You had crude computers in the 60s, but they weren't great really. So yeah, it's much easier now than it was then. It's still not easy, but yeah, you've got to look back at what some of the equipment they had. It was really pretty crude. You know, it was the best that was available in the time. You know, it was either the standard Neumann equipment, or going back before that, they'd have Scully lathes, which they're fun to work on, but really hard work, with Westrex cutting heads. And those heads were so heavy, they have a ball that runs in front, an advanced ball that takes the weight. So, you know, if you've got any dirt on the ball, it would leave a mark on the lacquer disc, which would then be on the pressing. Yeah, there's always problems with vinyl. It's always, you've got to cajole it to make it work. It has got easier. The technology has improved. But yeah, so people that came before me, they did some incredible work with some pretty crude equipment. I mean, the story I heard that Decca, when they heard the Neumann's 1968 brand of cutter head, they said, oh, good. It's good enough now that we can stop cutting at half speed. So it wasn't until that came along that they gave up doing things at half speed. It's got easier now. I mean, my custom system here is really true to the source now. You know, I'm not having to shave lots of bits off to try and make it cut and make it sound good on a record. But you know, in the past, you'd thinking, yeah, that bell tree sound, that's not going to cut, or that you can cut it, you just can't play it. But now there are ways to make it work. Is vinyl as good as it can get? And do I see improvements coming? I definitely see improvements coming. I've been talking with my lathe technician that I work with, and I've been pushing him for this for some time. We're looking at designing and building replacement amplifiers. Now, they're really good sounding amplifiers. They're just over there, over my my right shoulder there. Great sounding amplifiers, which Neumann designed for that cutter head. They're 600 watts per channel, and they're really, really good. But you know, the design's from 1974, so things can be improved upon that. Now, obviously, I've replaced all my transistors in my amp, so they're as good as new. So they're not 50-year-old soft transistors. They're really good. But we're looking at doing a custom new retrofit board, which will be the new amplifiers. We don't know yet at this stage if they're actually going to be any better. We might plug them all up, listen to it, and think, nope, it's not working. In which case, back to square one. Hopefully they will sound better. If they do, I'm going to work with my engineer and we'll probably actually double the power. Not to cut louder, because you can't really cut louder, they just distort. But if you've got more power at your disposal, you'll get better dynamic range and just better transient responses. So we're always looking at that. I've also met with a couple of people that are making newly designed cutting heads, and I might well be investing in one of those. I've got to do some tests yet. I've held one, not put it on the lathe and lined it up and had a play yet. But if it's as good as I suspect it may be, then I'll probably be replacing that. But so yeah, you can always look to things. You've just got to try to think, where are there any weaknesses in the chain? Is there anything we can do? So there are always things you can do to tweak it. Whether those things improve it or not, you know, you have to just make tests. So, and that's the scariest part of the process, really, when you put on a new component. I don't want to blow my cutter head up, because that's thousands of pounds to have repaired. Very expensive. And there's only two or three people in the world that can do it. So you don't really want to, you know, test my new amplifier. Let's cut this thing really loud and pop. You know, you've got some very expensive smoke. So I try, you know, we always do things very slowly and cautiously and carefully. But I'm hopeful when these amplifiers are ready that they will be good. I'm hopeful that when this cutter head is in production, that will be good. Don't know yet, but if it's better, and I will probably make the investment to improve my lathe, because I want it to be the best that it can possibly be. I'm always trying to just push it forward. It's already really clean and really true to the source, better than any lathe I've ever used in my 40 years. But, you know, there's always scope for improvement. But as we get better and better, the steps get smaller. So the ability to improve it is you're going to reach a limit eventually. But we're not there yet, so I'm always working on that. So let's just hope that the whole vinyl thing continues. You ask if the bubble's going to burst. I don't think it will. I mean, I don't think it's ever going to be a massive mass market product, but I think records will continue. A lot of people are looking at doing different formulations and more environmentally friendly pressings. I know several people that have got involved in that, and that's coming down the track. And there's just something magical about playing a record. You know, you're just taking it out of the sleeve and putting it on and then actually devoting 40 minutes to something, which is a lost art now. People don't do that so often. But when you do, when I sit at home and I put on a record, I'll play that. And when it finishes, I'll play another one and then another one and probably a fourth one. And you don't do that when you're listening to digital media. I might play an album or two or three songs and then, okay, turn that off now, do something else. It's just, there's something about the whole tactile process of handling a record, because you have to look after your records and you have to look after your player that you play them on. Otherwise, it sounds pretty terrible pretty quickly. And that kind of, you have a relationship with the media and with the machine that you play it on. And I think that all becomes part of the process. So the real music fans still love the format. What system do I use at home? I have a beautiful turntable made by a company called Vertair. They're a British company run by a maverick engineer called Turaj Moghaddam. He's fantastic, lovely, lovely man, and an absolute genius. his turntables are incredible, and he'll make lots of little tweaks here and there. He's a bit like me in the respect that I'm always fiddling with my lathe. He's fiddling with his turntables. You know, he once said, "Oh yeah, check this out." And he just sent me a belt. I said, "Am I really going to hear a difference with a belt?" He said, "Well, tell me." And I put it on. Chalk and cheese. I mean, mad. You know, and then a little while later, he gave me a new power supply to supply the power to the motor. And I said, "Well, am I really going to hear a difference?" You know, it's belt drive. So the motor's separated from the turntable. Put it on again, chalk and cheese. Everything was cleaner and smoother. The backgrounds were quieter. He's a really clever guy, and he makes beautiful looking and beautiful sounding turntables. So yeah, I have a Vertere turntable and one of his cartridges and one of his phono preamps, and its sound of it is to die for. I've played records on his player at my home, and I don't have his top system. I have kind of two thirds of the way up, and I've played stuff, and I've heard parts of a mix coming off the record that I've only heard on that player. Don't hear it on the hi-fi system here, the domestic system here. And so, that little keyboard sound did actually make it onto the disc that I knew was in the recording because I'd heard it on the main monitors. So it did make it there because I'm hearing it. So, wow. What are my favorite albums I haven't worked on? Well, I don't like playing records that I've worked on at home because, you know, that's just like being at work. And if I want to hear it, I can come here and hear it on the monitors in the studio. So, you know, it's better to do other stuff, you know, listen to other things. So my dad was a big jazz fan. He loved Duke Ellington. There's an album called Piano in the Background. That's amazing sounding. I like records by Yellow. They're really good. One of my best sounding albums actually was cut by my hero, a chap called Stan Ricker. He was the cutting engineer for Mobile Fidelity. He was the guy who really kind of pioneered this high quality half speed remaster of a classic album. But he would also do live direct to disc albums, and he did an album with Virgil Fox called The Fox Touch, which was direct to disc of a pipe organ in a church. It's stunning. Absolutely incredible. He claimed it was the best thing he'd ever cut. And you want to check out how good your speakers are and your woofers, put that on. So yeah, The Fox Touch by Virgil Fox. There's also a volume two. Something else that's quite interesting, again, a cut that Stan did, was he did an 1812 overture from an early digital recording. And on the sleeve, it actually says, "Warning, digital cannons." And the level of the cannons, probably 10 decibels above zero, which is insane. You know, you couldn't cut that now. And one of the grooves has a right angle turn in it. I'll play it later. It's very, yeah, because I want to hear it again now I'm talking about it. It's just mad. Another direct-to-disc cut was a Thelma Houston and Pressure Cooker. I Got the Music in Me. That's a great sounding record. Really good. You put that on and it's as if the band are in the room with you. Just jumps out the speakers. Feel funky. Woo! Feel real good, y'all. Woo! I'm gonna tell it all good on neighborhood, yeah. Put a fire up the ring. Hold on to your hat, honey. Sing. One of my highlights, really, of my career was working with Glyn Johns. And we had to break the rules at the time because this was during COVID. And we were not allowed, strictly not allowed, to have attended sessions. No clients were allowed in the room with me, just for health and safety reasons. Glyn and I both had to agree not to, you know, if either of us got sick, we wouldn't, you know, sue the other one. But he wanted to come in, he wanted to attend, he wanted to hear it, he wanted to see what was going on. And that's fair, because, you know, he did work on this album, you know, he put it all together, and it was finally seeing the light of day, not as a bootleg, as an official release. And it was the only time I've ever run a Beatles master tape on the machine. You know, as I said before, they don't take them out of the archive willy-nilly. They stay in the archive and they're not touched to preserve them. But because that album has never been officially released, and because Glyn wanted to work off of the tape came up and I had it in my hands, and there it was, the Beatles, you know, on the machine. So yeah, it was great. And he came in and he was a great guy, and it actually sounded pretty good. So most of the ideas he wanted to do, I had the same kind of feeling. I said, this track sounds a little bit bass-like, can we just give it a bit? He goes, yes, like this, you know. So yeah, it was really good fun, good fun. And it was great for him, actually, I feel, that he could, we could right the wrong of that album not seeing the light of day for 50 years, because I like that version. You know, I think it's as worthy as anything else. My favourite Beatles album. Well, difficult. Used to be Revolver. I used to love Revolver. I thought it was fantastic. But when the reissue version came out a couple of years ago, Universal did a special presentation box for the top executives around the world, and they wanted to include an acetate in every box. So I had to cut it 39 times. So back to the Band-Aid story. It's a great record, but you don't want to spend day after day after day doing nothing but that. So I'm probably ready to listen to it again now, actually. It's been a couple of years. But I would say pretty much not both absolute extremities, but I love Abbey Road. And I've always had a soft spot for A Hard Day's Night, which was one of the first ones I had. My nan gave me with the Beatles and Beatles for Sale when I was really young. And I was very upset that She Loves You wasn't on either of them, you know, so kept looking for it, like looking at the sleeve, thinking if I look long enough, it will turn up. Never did, of course. And I loved the film Hard Day's Night. So I got the cassette initially, then I had the LP. So I love that album. It's just, I don't know, they were really kind of hitting their stride, I think, for Hard Day's Night. So that's a great album. And I just think Abbey Road was a really great way to say, okay, we're done, but this is it. Although it wasn't the last album to get released, it was the last thing they recorded, and they went out on a high. So both of those. But I, you know, listening to the Beatles is not a chore for me. It's easy. Even at half speed, it's pretty good.
I'd like to say a huge thank you to Universal for allowing me in, and to everyone at Abbey Road for their cooperation and hospitality. Special thanks, of course, to Miles, who was so kind and generous with his time. He really is one of the good guys and made my day there one I will never forget. I'll be back next week with another video from my Abbey Road trip, so make sure you hit the subscribe button and notification bell so you don't miss out on that. In the meantime, why not watch our video about the best sounding pressing of the Beatles' Abbey Road album and let me and everyone else know what you think of it.